keep the pit dry so they can actually work in it. And with the consequences of, like mentioned this morning, that you make whole layers dry with some humidity together and some rain in it, that you get the acid drainage. And then that's the amount of rainfall there and the amount of water used in total. If you sum the number of things up, you get that. This claim then, that's, that are figures from Yanacocha mine itself, that they use themselves in the whole process 4 million cubic meters a year. The water they discharge in their statistics is about 44 million, which corresponds somewhat to the water taken up by agriculture and domestic. Domestic, remember, the captation for drinking water, and agriculture or irrigation places. So if you add those up, you'll get somewhat in the same order of magnitude. So that sounds logic to me. I don't expect here that this number is accurate. Eh? Okay. So I know we all have a dream of sustainable mining. I have a bit of problems believing in that, but my thing would say the mining companies in general have not so much of respect for the local population. They feel themselves a bit above the ground. The big problem is that the underground is a concession and the topsoil is private property, so there's a whole fight for area. There is a propaganda machine all the time, so they say, okay, the people opposing the mine, they're just drug smugglers, they're criminals, cover up for criminals and all this type of thing, which of course is pure propaganda. And my big question, and I have very big doubts about it, that's impossible, open cast mining and environmental impact. I don't think there is a solution. I don't see it. So if somebody can convince me otherwise, I'm prepared to listen, but I don't really see it. And especially what after the closure. Remember, we have these big pits. Just leave it. The water will go up. Maybe some of the springs will start running again, but they will not pump anymore to the Rio Grande. So there will be also from the water, I'm just looking now at the water sources. Eh? There are many other things. There will be a kind of whole issue, what will happen? They will not pump anymore for sure. So this type of start of the Rio Grande will be finished. And what then with the drinking water? What with the irrigation systems? So I don't know. This is propaganda. Eh? Fantastic. I showed you a picture of the Lagunas de Alto Peru, the nice Ihalca system, you remember? And now, the consultancy engineer, somehow in his office, he had some grass, he put it on the picture. He has some trees, all the same, some, he put a bit of different color. And that's how it will be. Yeah? That's how Yanacocha puts it in the document. Huh? It's not even possible, in my opinion. Yeah, the local community and the Opiegas will be there and the Pacas will be there. Yeah. So this is just stupid propaganda because it's not even possible at an altitude of 3,000 to 4,000 feet to realize that. I've seen in Paramo that they put pine trees and after 20 years they're that high. This is not a scandal ecologically, but that's another matter. So everything can be sold. They put a bit of chalk on it and a bit of fertilizer, and perfect. Eh? That's how it will be afterwards. I'm not that optimistic. This picture you have seen already. This is slightly later than the one you've shown, so I don't have to explain that. Yanacocha means cocha is laguna or lake, better said. And Yana means dark, that's one of the few words in Quechua I know. So this means a dark lake because of the very deep nature. So this is how it changes. This research was done in the framework of a team project where Peter is also involved, and you will have give a talk on the bioindicators and so forth. So with the University of Cajamarca, which we try to be a better, make as a better expert in water sources. Unfortunately, with the new university law from July 2014 in Peru, all the universities are in a big mess now. That's really, the ones in Lima are a bit better, but the regional ones are really in a mess of who's rector, who's not rector, and So I heard some places that had two rectors at the same time. The old one didn't want to go and the new one was elected. Or administration, but we don't recognize this rector, so, so it's not an easy project. Okay, thank you very much.
So this is the map of Peru, the regions. Here is Cajamarca, and here is Apurímac. These are the two regions that I'm investigating. So the mining claims increased tremendously, and the state developed the role of mining promoter, but also regulator of those activities. So kind of in the ambiguous term. Now talking about water management in the country, by law, water belongs to the country, to the nation. Nobody can buy or negotiate or trade water. So the state owns the resource. It's not a commodity. You can access to water if you ask for license, permits or other authorizations. So you can have water rights for irrigation, for drinking water purposes, and for industrial purposes as well. However, the law is with this type of modernization of the not only what the mining sector but also the water sector, the law prioritizes the uses or the user that is having the most effective and productive and somehow not necessarily sustainable actions, but more kind of focuses on efficiency and productivity. So that is also how mining companies are kind of legitimizing or justifying their actions in the country regarding managing water. The theoretical lenses that I use for this presentation or for this idea is just a working paper at this moment, so it's just trying some ideas to see how to understand dynamics on the local level. It's the water governance and the everyday politics. What I understand about governance is that goes beyond the actions of states or state individuals or state entities, and it's not only an exclusive question of governance anymore, but it's just a construction and a kind of act that comes with negotiation and participation. However, by looking only at those type of ideas, you can miss the contested part of governance or doing governing on the field. The political part and also all the intrigue situations that you can find. In that sense, if you only consider the nice part of negotiation, participation and integration of actors, we can miss some political problems, let's say, or political issues.